Good morning.
Good morning.
There were some notes up here I hadn't written. We welcome all of you to Little Rock this morning. I was commenting to some of the young couples over there, it's a shame to have to resign to pack out the church. Ray, you can look forward to this. Marshwant will be full once again whenever you resign. Yeah. Glad to have all of you here, a lot of people. My best friend in the world, Ray Wells, my distant kissing cousin, Julie, his wife. We're so glad to have them here. And also John and Kevin and Pluma, and you've all heard from about her a lot. And then Mr. and Mrs. Hyatt, Jack and Beverly Hyatt, John's parents, and John's sister, Carrie, her husband, Michael Miller, and Harlow, who will be how old? Five. Okay. And when you get these two first cousins together and the other two that go with them, oh well, it's fun. It's fun. Anyway, good to have so many of you here today to worship with us. It's great. Friends from a long time back. I got to say, yesterday, I'm going to try to get this out of the way and get finished with this. Yesterday was a marvelous day. Carolyn and I were so overwhelmed with so many, that just so many, and people I had never thought coming, our families, just so many. It was, darn it, it was such a good thing, and just a good day, and thank you. And for all of the countless hours and all the people that made that happen yesterday, geez, it was just unbelievable. And I hope, there were so many good things, I can't begin to name them all, but I hope you'll take time to take a look at this painting here that was done by one of our members. And I won't single her out because she wouldn't like me to do that. But she's Tim Wiggs' wife. But see, Beth, I didn't call your name. But anyway, it's just such a great day, and I don't know who's gonna come, but they won't be as funny as me. Yeah, and they won't be as forgetful, my wife says, and I hope not.
And they won't wear as many costumes.
And they won't wear as many different costumes.
They will if I have
anything. and you probably will. But it's just wonderful. And some members who were here many years ago come back for the day. Thank you. It's just wonderful, and I'm going to stop this while I can still talk, because I do have a message that I'm going to preach. I may be the only one left, but that's okay. I'm going to do it. Okay. You want to do your thing?
I do have a few announcements. I'm not going to go over all the announcements. They're in your bulletin insert. There's dates in the bulletin insert. So please be sure that you look at your bulletin insert for the upcoming events. There is a correction. The deacons will meet Thursday at 7 p.m. instead of tomorrow night. And I want to make sure I get the funeral arrangements.
Thank you, because I didn't have that.
I think most of you have heard that Ronnie and Kathy's granddaughter, Lila Grace, did pass away. They will be meeting at Wilkerson Funeral Home in Greenville tonight from 6 to 9, is that correct? And then there's a graveside service tomorrow. It is on the Facebook page. I can't seem to find it right this second, but it's in Martin County, so look on the Facebook page if you plan to go, or if you're not on Facebook, if you'll contact us or one of the many members of the family. I'm sure someone can tell you where it's at. And there has been a request from the usher board and the deacons that we know there's a crowd here today, but please be patient when exiting, and please, unless you physically cannot exit out that door, please go by and be sure to give your greetings to Mr. D. We think he deserves everyone to go by and speak to him today. At this time, we have a couple of special recognitions.
I was afraid of that.
As the other people are getting in place, I just wanted to share some things, because when I was talking with some people, they said, well, you know, I've known Dee the whole time he's been here, and I never knew that. This is not the only church that Dee has ever pastored. He did not found this church, Jerry. He did pastor three other churches prior to coming here. And, you know, Miss Sally Farrell said the first time that she met him that she met the little boy that came to get the hammer. So I'm sure he was really a little boy when he pastored these other churches. But he was ordained in 1965 at Stony Creek Free Will Baptist Church. This is his 51st year in the ministry, and 47 of those have been here at Little Rock. Prior to coming to Little Rock, he served 9 months as an interim at Hillsbury Mission Church in Clinton. He served 3 years simultaneously at Casey's Chapel in Goldsboro and Rudy Branch in Mount Olive. Both of those were halftime churches. And according to Reverend Buddy Sasser, our denominational headquarters director, he said that Dee is the longest tenured pastor at the same church on record for our denomination. Some have pastored 30 plus years, but no one has reached 47. Ray, you may can be the record, I don't know. Don't think so. And as I'm sure many of you can attest to, he has had 390 baptisms, 300 weddings, 250 funerals, 70 plus child dedications, and 100 plus revivals. And I'm not sure if those numbers are deflated or not. They're probably more than that. Well, who's first? Ray's first. Come on.
Oh, no. You know way too much about me, Ray.
I'm not going to say anything about you.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Good.
Yes. This is a professional presentation.
All right. Cool.
So stand up here.
Okay. I don't know whose notes those are. They're not mine.
No, you don't write that well.
No, I don't.
I have this little plaque for you. And I didn't do this. It's not from me to you.
Okay. That makes you feel better.
Yeah. It says, in sincere appreciation to the Reverend Dr. D. Wayne Eakes for 47 years of commitment and exceptional leadership to the Wilson County Ministers Association, including serving as president for 2 years and treasurer for 11 years, presented this day, April the 10th, 2016.
Well, thank you.
See, I told you it'd be simple.
Simple.
I could say more, but I'm not.
Tough yourself.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Love you.
I love you too.
I do want to tell you one story. Because this is one of the funniest things that ever happened. We were at the Western Conference meeting at Rains Crossroads Free Will Baptist Church. And Carolyn and I were out, it was lunch break, and Carolyn and I were talking to each other, and the Reverend Floyd Cherry came up. And he said, "Well, Ray, how are you?" I said, "I'm fine." He said, "Mrs. Wells, how are you?" And Carolyn said, "I'm fine." And then Dee comes up. He says, "Honey, can I have $5 for lunch?" She says, "Sure," and hands it to him. And the look on Dr. Cherry's face was priceless. So that's my story.
That's
God bless you. Look, and I'll be here no matter how long you preach, I'll be right there.
All right. It's one of your better sermons.
Thank you.
And the Ministers Association also has given over $250 to the endowment at the University of Mount Olive that is in yours and Carolyn's name.
Wow, thank you.
All right, get back up here.
Get back up here.
And Miss Carolyn, I know you don't want to. Come on. Stand beside Mr. D. On behalf of our congregation, this comes from the whole church, we have placed both of your names on the wall of honor at the original Free Will Baptist headquarters. The Reverend Dr. D. Wayne and Mrs. Carolyn Eakes have been included on the convention wall of honor and recognized with love and in gratitude for 47 years of pastoral ministry to our congregation and the Lucama community, and for your faithfulness to the Word of God and your support of the original Free Will Baptist denomination.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay up here.
Oh, hey.
Hey, it's me.
Your turn.
I'm not a professional pronunciator like all these other people, so I had to have my people write my stuff for me.
doubt that.
This man is not a man of few words.
I tend to ramble, but I won't today. For us, this is a tough day, isn't it? I told Doug and Dana back in the sound booth, I said, I don't know how many times I've done this, but I'm actually nervous today. Miss Carolyn, a long time ago you chose Jesus and then you chose Dee, or should we say you chose each other. God brought you to Little Rock as newlyweds, and we know the rest of the story. Together you have given so much and shown your love for God by caring for his family in this body of Christ. We thank you for adjusting your life and supporting Dee as he met the needs of this growing congregation. Through the years you have shared with him and with us, experienced dinners interrupted, late nights and long vigils during crisis times, hours of study as he prepared sermons, delayed trips with last minute detours when he said, before we leave, we need to run by the church. With so many needs, there was always something to do. Most of all, we thank you for becoming a part of each and every family in this church, for loving us and accepting our love in return. We know how much you enjoy flowers, and we have seen your talent in making beautiful arrangements. And we'd like to continue to create and think of us each time you use this crystal vase. And that is for you.
Thank you.
Okay. Dee, you've been on call 24/7 for 47 years. Now, you know how bad I am at math, so you know I didn't write this. This breaks down into 411,960 hours, 716,600 minutes, and that includes a leap day. During his time with us, he has been an example of Ephesians 2:10. We are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. God had a strong congregation waiting at Little Rock 47 years ago, and he had been preparing Dee for the good work he needed to do. During these years, he has become our friend and our pastor, and he has been with us at all kinds of times for weeping, rejoicing, praying, and praising. And we all know from Ecclesiastes there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. And now it is time for him to have some good time on his hands.
Mm-hmm. We'll see about that.
To spend time with his family and carry on the good work that God began in him in whatever way God leads. As we share in his retirement, we know that no amount of time or space can separate him from his church and all the people who are meant to be in his life. He will be in our hearts and prayers. So with time in mind, we present you with this watch so that each time you check your watch, you will remember us and say a prayer for your congregation at Little Rock. And we also ask that you accept this commemorative plaque to note your 47 years of service to the church family.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay.
My wife
normally
wants to have the last word.
No, I don't. Other than I'm not going anywhere. Thank you for loving me and accepting me, and it's been wonderful. It's been a good ride, bumping the roads, but that's life. This is home, and I love all of you. We've enjoyed walking with you through the hard times, the good times, and being a part of your family, and you are our family. Thank you, and I do love all of you.
What she said.
That's
please stand and join us in the responsive call to worship? For making us your creatures,
we thank you,
our God. For calling us as your servants,
we obey you, O Lord.
For adopting us as your children,
we love you, our Father.
For sending us as your disciples, we honor you, our Savior. Amen.
Cam Ash, would you lead us?
Thank you for the many lives that Dee has touched in his many years of ministry. We thank you for the great influence he has been in our denomination. We thank you for the wonderful model he has been for you. And Lord, personally, I thank you for him being such a great role model for me and my ministry. Lord, as we continue in this worship hour, we just ask that you would be with us, to shine your light through us, and help us to continue to learn to be better people for you. And we pray all this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Our opening hymn is page 277, The Church's One Foundation.
Greet your neighbors and wish them God's blessings. Okay. They didn't get a chance to do it in choir. I got discharged out of there. Yeah. It annoys the choir if it's not pointed
right.
Yes,
they were having
a oh, see, you know not.
Thank you.
Our Psalter lesson this morning comes from Psalm 25, verses 1 and verses 4 through 10. Psalm 25, verses 1 and 4 through 10. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his decrees. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As has already been stated, you know the little pink bracelets were worn for Lila Grace Watson. And as has been said, please remember that family, especially those young parents who are going through so much right now. I can't imagine what they're experiencing and hope no one else ever has to. Are there any other prayer requests that anyone would speak? How about uplifted hands? Oh, yes. Praise item. I've been asked just to remind you and to look over here at this flower, because we had a praise a birth yesterday. Kayla and Brandon Curry, they put the blue and the pink just in case. Is that the wrong one? That's for who? Oh, I'm sorry. I got it all wrong. There's too much going on. It's Jessica's birthday, Jessica Mayo, and this is for her brother, Matt. Okay, I'm sorry. Too much going on. Thank you for correcting me. All right? See, I told you I make lots of mistakes. All right, are there any other praise items in? None? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God of grace and love, on this unique day, visit us with your presence, as always. Fill us with your spirit as we gather in this sacred time of worship and of fellowship. We bring, as always, our deepest needs. We bring our greatest losses. We bring also our brightest hopes and our highest aspirations, Lord, to you. In prayer. In this day, we come with great thanksgiving for your myriad blessings, your numerous, innumerable, really, expressions of grace, and for your extravagant love manifest in this time of worship and fellowship. As we express our love for you through the beautiful music, beautifully written and shared, as we read and hear your word and prayerfully hear it appropriately proclaimed, inspire us both in the mission and in the message of Jesus and in the vision of a world at peace, reconciled in Christ our risen Lord, for we pray in his name.
Around and warm up in its glowing. Brave in the angry day.
We continue our worship as we praise the Lord with our gifts. In the 12th chapter of Luke, verse 48, Jesus said, "From everyone to whom much has been given, much will be required. And from the one to whom much has been entrusted, even more will be demanded." Jesus' words here are very easy to understand. As we are blessed, we are expected to share grace and love and be blessings to others. May our gifts, our tithes, our offerings always be an expression of gratitude for the greatness and generosity of our Lord.
blessings of life. We just ask that you take these tithes and offerings and use them for the upbuilding of your kingdom. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated, I guess. Have to look around. I just got to show this. Another one of our kids turned in their Lenten offering thing today. If you folks would follow the kids, we could do something here. Just to remind you.
Our epistle lesson this morning comes from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 20. 1 John chapter 4, 7 through 20. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen him and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this way, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. If you will join me in the prayer for peace written by St. Francis of Assisi. Let us pray. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Amen.
Jerusalem, Jerusalem.
Thank you. Thank you. They know that's one of my favorites. Ray, there's not a great deal they don't know. but what you know that they don't know, let's keep it like that. That's right. Richard, I hope you can listen longer than that, but if you can't, that's okay. Well, you have a short attention span. Okay. Oh, me. It's one in every crowd, and we love ours. So. My text today is taken, as you can see, from John chapter 13. For me, that entire text is a defining text, but especially the verses 34 and 35 that I have selected as the main text. And I hope you will read the section, but I'm just going to read those two verses. And here they are. No, I can't do that, right? I can't just take those verses. I'm going to read the whole text. I can't do that. Beginning at chapter 13, verse 31. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in Him. If God has been glorified in Him, God will also glorify Him in Himself, and will glorify Him at once." And I love this. Little children, I'm with you a little longer. You will look for Me. And I said to the Jews, "So now I say to you, where I'm going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are My disciples, if you have love for one another." The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, this is it. My last official sermon as senior pastor of Little Rock, Regional Free Will Baptist Church. I knew this time was coming at some point, but this time is now. 47 years, Ray. You've been at Marsh Swamp 37. 47 years. Have I had the opportunity to stand in this pulpit and expound on a sacred text, and hopefully proclaim the Word of God. I've tried to be faithful. Hope and pray that I have. But one more time, I've got to say, thank you. Thank you for these years, for your patience, for teaching me in allowing me to share with you. Marcy made some reference to how young we were when we went to the other churches. Well, they didn't want much, and I tried to fulfill that. You guys demanded a little more, and I tried to do that. I don't know. But anyway, my initial sermon preached in this pulpit was July the 6th, 1969. The text was 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I still have the sermon in my files. I don't know why, Ray. I've never used it since. But I didn't even pull it out to look at it, because that's not where I wanted to go today. Today's message is on the same broad theme of love as you have gathered from the readings from the service. And its title is Love's Unlimited Power, or Unlimited Power of Love. And I believe that it's unlimited. Many of you will know that the Greek has at least four different words for love. But in 1 Corinthians 13, in the 1 John text that was read, and in the text that I read, the word for love is a word that transliterates from Greek into English as agape. That's the love the New Testament talks about for the most part. That's the love Jesus taught, exemplified, died and rose to prove the power of. That's the love that's defined as sacrificial love, as selfless love, as self-giving love, a love that is given for the benefit of the beloved with no thought of getting anything in return. And sometimes you do get something in return when you give that love. Sometimes you don't, but that's not the reason for giving it. As Pluma Rose says, sometimes you get what you get and don't pitch a fit. Did I get that right, darling? Yeah. That's the kind of love that Christ has. It's the kind of love that caused a former member of this congregation to donate a kidney to her brother. It's the kind of love that prompts people to go to the Red Cross stations every time they have the opportunity and give blood. And those of us who've had to have surgeries that require that appreciate those gifts. You're giving life. What greater gift? That's the love of Jesus Christ. The love that gives life. That's the love he's talking about in this John text. So I want to consider the text for what it presents in context, the unlimited power of love. The chapter began with a presentation of John's unique account of Jesus washing the disciples' feet, the night on which one of that group of 12 would betray him to the authorities in the dark, and the night on which the one that he called the rock, Peter, would deny him three times before the rooster crowed the next morning or the next day. That's where this text comes from, following that account. And then in verses 34 and 35, we move to what, if there is a litmus test for Christianity, it is verses 34 and 35 of John's Gospel. Jesus' words. Jesus is saying, this new commandment I'm giving you is that you love each other as I have loved you. Wow, what a standard. He said, the way people will know that you are my disciples is not because of your name being on a church roll, but I think that's important. It's not because you say you believe in the Lord and love Him. It's because your interactions with each other, your actions prove the love. They will know you are my disciples by your love, which is nothing more than Christ's love that we're privileged to reflect to the world around us. Wow. What a challenge. What an opportunity. Jesus said, I will give you a new commandment. Was it really a new commandment? No. You can find it in the book of Leviticus, Deuteronomy. It's not new. It was centuries old, thousands of years old by the time Jesus said, I give you a new commandment. Well, if it wasn't new, why did Jesus say it was new? Because He put a new direction on it. He redefined what the word meant by His life. That's what made it new. Jesus didn't say, this is the law, do it. He says, this is my commandment, a new commandment to you. Look at me and I'll show you how to do it. And then you do it the way I'm showing you. That made it very, very new. It's the love that's evidenced in John 1:14, where it says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and glory. It's the Word Jesus was talking about and the commandment Jesus was talking about when He said to Nicodemus that night in the dark as the Pharisee came seeking from Jesus, when He said, God so loved the world that He gave. He gave Himself for it. I wish all these preachers that insult Jesus by saying the world is so bad would read John 3:16 again. Must not be so bad if God died for it. At the heart of Jesus' revelation of God is the way. God made His love visible and tangible to this world. Greater love, Jesus said, has no person but that they would lay down their life for a friend. And you are my friends. How many times in our human history have we seen individuals do that for someone else? Oh, the stories of that kind of battlefield sacrifice are unending. Every time fire and rescue people go out to answer a call, they don't know what they're going to find. They're doing that. Every time an officer of the law goes to work, they don't know what they'll face before they get home, if they get home. Every time a new mother goes into labor, she doesn't know what's going to happen next. And then do you remember that story about the subway when someone fell in the tracks? The train was coming. Complete stranger standing right there on the platform, closest person to that person, the only person that could save them. jumped down, got the person out, and made it themselves. Didn't know when he got down there if he'd get that person out or I get out himself, but he did. It's that kind of love. Now that's agape at its peak. Well, Jesus focused so specifically on love within and among the members of the faith community that sometimes we may miss its radical nature. And sometimes we may run in danger of just thinking it's just all about us in our faith community. And it does have to be strong. And the stronger, the better. But if it's just about us in the faith community, then we've missed the whole point of Jesus' love, because it's to share it with everybody else outside. Because you see, the church isn't built to build barriers and walls. Jesus didn't say, "On this rock I build my church," for us to be a bastion against the world. He said, "Go out and get the world and bring them in to me." Inclusive, not exclusive. That's the kind of love he's talking about here. Or, as the ancient prophet Micah said, verse 6-8, Ms. Esther, one of your favorites. "He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God." Or Jesus' half-brother, James, in 1:27, "Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to care for the orphans and the widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained from the world." What is being presented here by the ancient prophet, by the apostle, by Jesus, is the radical call of agape love. Discrimination against the poor, the powerless, the oppressed, the attempts to build walls to marginalized groups of society are all violations of Jesus' dictum, love one another. Now, as a church and as people, there are times we get it right. Praise God. There are times we don't get it right. Lord, forgive us. Redirect us. We all have room to grow. And the way we grow is to understand that the church's witness has always got to be so very careful that we don't allow it to become diminished by our prejudice, our hatred, or our lack of love at times in our dealings with each other and with the world around us. It's easy to judge others. I can tell my brother Ray what he needs to do to have a better ministry. He can tell me, and does, what I could do to have a better ministry. But I have trouble seeing my own. And there was an obscure Galilean named Jesus who said, "Judge not." I mean, that's pretty clear. None of us have the right to judge another human being. And one of the hardest things I've ever had to do was be called on a jury for a trial and know that my job was to sit there and pass judgment on somebody's life. And a prosecuting attorney asked me, "Could I give the death penalty if that was called for?" I said, "Sir, I can't answer that question until I've heard all the evidence, and then I'm not sure." "Oh, that'll get you off, by the way." He didn't want me. The defense attorney wanted me, but the prosecuting attorney didn't want me. I understand. I wasn't going to lie in court on oath. Try not to do it any time, but certainly not there. That term, a new commandment, is used four times in John's Gospel. A new commandment. Previously, this love commandment was thought to be just internal. Jesus made it clear, as I've tried to make it clear, that's wrong. That's an external thing. Once in a while, as I said, we see people who understand this kind of love and who are willing to do it. There was a man who was assassinated on April 4th, 1964. His name was Martin Luther King Jr. Now, a lot of people didn't like him. A lot of people hated him. Some of his own people hated him. But because of his ministry and the stance he took, it cost him his life. Now, he didn't plan to be assassinated at 39 years of age. But he had to be faithful to what he knew his calling was. In San Salvador, El Salvador, there was a bishop, some of you may remember this, Oscar Romero. He was the fourth Archbishop of San Salvador. He spoke out very strongly against poverty and social injustices and assassinations and tortures that were going on in his country. He was assassinated March the 24th, 1980 at age 63 because of his conviction and stance. These two and so many others have lived and died to the best of their understanding by the dictates of Jesus' new commandment. Thankfully, most of us are not called upon to make that hard of a decision. But we are called upon to be ambassadors of this love of Jesus Christ everywhere we go. It's pretty easy to be good at church, as long as the preacher's not too long or doesn't step on my particular hurts too much. But it's not so easy some other settings that we may be in. And that's our challenge, isn't it? This new commandment Jesus gave then is the challenge for the church in every age, and especially this church now in this time of transition. And I know excuse me. I'll wake you up. I know because I know you that you will make the right decision. Because I know that you understand this love Christ talked about. And I pray that God will give us all the power to live it. And I believe you will. May we pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Christ's name. Amen. As always, we invite anyone here, if you have any prayer that you need to bring to the Lord, please don't hesitate because of this day being what it is. Please bring it. If there's anyone here He feels a need to unite with this part of the body of Christ from any other part. Please do that today. Don't put it off because of the hour or the nature of the service. You're here without Jesus Christ, and you feel a need to make a faith response to Him. Please do that today. We've got time for that.
Our invitation to Faith Hymn is page 448, A Charge to Keep I Have. Please stand.
All of you know this lady, Ann Godwin, well, Ann Barnes Godwin.
Yeah, don't forget to put that
on. That was it. Ann is moving her Perdition's Church to move her membership. Do I have a motion she be received? All right. All in favor, vote amen.
Amen.
Oh, no negative votes. God bless you. I'm going to embarrass her a little bit now. How long has it been that I've been asking you about this? can either one of us remember exactly?
You've been here 47 years.
47 years. That's right. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Ann. There's something I want to share with you. That's my, my benedictory benediction from Carolyn and myself, because I mean every word of it to you. It's one of the many Irish blessings. May the roads rise to meet you. May the winds be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. The rains fall softly upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of His hand. All God's people said, amen. Thank you. Where they are.
get her attention and she won't look at me. Tell her to me.
Call her a name. Kitty.
Kitty.
I can't do
it. I'm not. Are you going to the visitation? Are y'all going in the group?
I'm teaching next Sunday because Miss Kay's going to be gone, so they can come on back.
Mark's going to come too.
Good, I'll teach Mark too.